quadruple murder shocks a small town in Florida. The mastermind behind the violence, Scott Burnside, is nowhere to be found.
We looked everywhere for Burnside. He was on the run. He was gone.
He flees the country to a South Pacific island.
He ran as far as he could possibly run.
And sends the police audio tapes to taunt them.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. This is Scott Burnside. Let's just cut the crap here, guys.
Police are now on a desperate manhunt to track him down. Criminals sometimes try to escape from justice. This is the story of how one man almost got away with it. July 1990, a ranch right outside Gainesville, Florida. 29-year-old Scott Burnside is in a workshop building a homemade gun silencer out of pipe and steel wool.
Hey, buddy.
What's up, awesome?
How you doing?
His best friend, Dorsey Sanders, joins him. They go over the final details of a plan.
Sounds pretty good, man. Nice.
It's a plan to kill Dorsey's mother, Joanne Sanders.
The plan was to catch Joanne Sanders when she was alone, kill her, don't get caught doing it, and get paid.
Dorsey's father, Doc Sanders, is in the midst of a bitter divorce. He's been ordered to give his ex-wife, Joanne, almost half of his assets. Dorsey's not about to sit by and watch his inheritance disappear.
The assets totaled well over $1 million.
For Burnside, it's not about cash or property. He simply wants to impress Dorsey and his father. Anthony Totti is the assistant state attorney working on the case.
Scott Burnside perceived Dr. Sanders to be, you know, a money pit, and he had ingratiated himself with the family and convinced them that he was the guy that could make things happen.
Doc's son, Dorsey, is like a brother to Burnside.
Dorsey became pretty much my best friend. Me and him actually developed a good business relationship as well and opened International Auto Sales just outside of Gainesville.
Burnside's used car lot business allows him to take care of his family, his wife Tanya, who he married in 1988, and his son Charlie from his first wife. By mid-July 1990, the Sanders divorce has reached a boiling point. A judge has ordered Doc to pay Joanne a large portion of her settlement, $171,000.
Doc was actually having to write her a check, and that's what made things, I guess, explode.
Dorsey's determined to protect his inheritance. Burnside helps him come up with a plan. Eliminate Dorsey's mother, Joanne.
Do this, man.
But get someone else to do the dirty work. Burnside recruits John Barrett, a mechanic at the used car lot, to commit the murder.
He started working for us part-time to make a little extra money, pay off one of his cars that he was short of paying for.
Hey, Barrett, how's it going, man?
Burnside offers Barrett $20,000 to kill Joanne Sanders. By late July, Burnside is ready to pull the trigger on the plot. He sends Barrett to Joanne's home in Floral City, Florida, to do the job.
He had parked his car out on the side of 41. And under a ruse, went up to the house saying his car was broken down and it was needing water.
Barrett approaches Joanne's house. To his surprise, he sees two men standing outside of Joanne's home. He pretends his radiator is leaking and asks them for water.
He was going to commit the murders then, but he somewhat backed out. He didn't like something about what was happening there, so he left.
2 weeks later, on August 3rd, Burnside sends Barrett back to Joanne's home. This time, Barrett's carrying the gun with a homemade silencer and a large knife. He's hoping to find Joanne alone.
He brought some beer in, started drinking beer with her and her fiancé, Jerry Lee Clark, and some guy that was helping remodel the kitchen, and they were hanging out.
Joanne is growing suspicious of Barrett's intentions. She notices a large knife and a bulky object tucked in his pants. Thinking back to her messy divorce, She wonders if Barrett was hired by her ex-husband to spy on her. Then, Joanne receives an emergency Hello? Call that her mother is sick.
Hi. Oh my God. Okay, bye. I gotta go.
Around 4 p.m., Joanne leaves the house. On her way out, she notices something odd. Barrett's truck is parked far away, instead of in front of the house.
It bothered her enough that she wrote down the tag number on the truck as she was leaving.
With Joanne gone, her carpenter Roger Wilson and fiancé Jerry Clark head out to run a few errands, leaving Barrett alone in the house. Barrett anxiously waits for Joanne to return home. This time, he decides nothing will stop him from finishing the job.
Oh, Johnny, great to see you here.
Wilson returns alone after an hour. When he turns his back, Barrett pulls the trigger and puts a 9mm bullet in his head. With Wilson out of the way, Barrett once again waits for Joanne to return. Barrett checks his gun and notices it's jammed. He's going to need another weapon. Meanwhile, Scott Burnside is at the used car lot, 80 miles away. He has no idea that the plot he helped create is spiraling out of control. Back at Joanne's house, Clark returns with his neighbor, Robert Hemingway. Barrett surprises them, brandishing his pistol. They have no idea it's jammed.
Down on the ground. Down on the ground!
He then uses the hatchet to bash their heads. He slashes their throats with a knife. Barrett now has another problem. A neighbor on the street stops by the house, looking for Hemingway. Barrett feels he has no choice but to beat him with a hatchet. He then cuts his throat and drags his bloody body to the bedroom closet.
He eliminated four people, killed them, to wait on Joanne Sanders to come back home.
Back at the used car lot, Burnside nervously waits for news, hoping that he can keep his hands clean. 7 hours later, after taking care of her mother, Joanne returns home. She sees Roger Wilson slumped in a corner.
Hey, Roger.
Thinking he had too much to drink, she moves on to her bedroom. Confused, she looks and is horrified at the scene before her. Within minutes, a team of investigators rushes to Joanne's home. Citrus County Sheriff Charles Dean has witnessed dozens of murders in Florida. But when he arrives, he's shocked by the carnage.
Ah, Judd, look at that.
That was a gory murder.
Man, what a mess.
To discover that you've had four people murdered in daylight and not have any direct eyewitness, it's a pretty traumatic occasion.
Captain Jerry Thompson examines the evidence.
I've seen gruesome scenes before, but not with the body count that this one produced.
The forensics team carefully examines the footprints, tire tracks, and blood spatter from the killings. As police work the crime scene, Barrett heads to Melrose, Florida, to report back to Burnside.
Where have you been, man?
There were four. He looked like he was kind of drunk and crazy. His eyes were kind of wild. He told me he killed four men.
Burnside's murder plot is a complete fiasco. Four men are dead, and the intended target, Joanne Sanders, is unharmed. Burnside's now worried he'll be connected to the crime.
Why is this truck here?
I asked him, were you driving that vehicle when you did this?
Yeah.
I said, where was this vehicle parked when you killed these women? Well, we found out in front of her house. The vehicle was a vehicle that I had just taken in on trade at the car lot. My immediate concern was that the authorities are going to come. They're coming. I know they're coming.
The intended victim, Joanne Sanders, gives police the license tag number from the suspicious truck. Within hours, authorities trace the vehicle tag to International Auto Sales, a used car lot in Melrose, Florida. The owners are Dorsey Sanders, Joanne's son, and his business partner, Scott Burnside.
Immediately, the bells and whistles started going off because Melrose is where the ex-husband lived. Now it began to genuinely appear to be an attempt to kill Joanne Sanders that had gone bad.
Back at the station, police learn about the messy divorce between Doc Sanders and his ex-wife Joanne. They also learn about John, the mysterious visitor who stopped by Joanne's home on several occasions. Armed with this new evidence, Citrus County detectives go to the car lot to question Burnside. They discover that the license tag number Joanne gave them from John's truck is connected to an individual named John Barrett, a mechanic who works for Burnside. Police arrest Barrett less than a week after the murders. He confesses to police that the quadruple murder was the result of a botched plot to kill Joanne Sanders. And he tells police it was Scott Burnside who hired him to do the killing.
And I don't believe these people that were the victims ever were they intended to be the victim. They just innocently walked in on a terrible situation and as a result of it lost their life.
There is no question in my mind that Burnside was the cause of John Barrett going to this mobile home to kill these people.
On August 11th, 8 days after the murders, Dorsey Sanders and Scott Burnside are charged with conspiracy to commit murder. At this point, the two fugitives are nowhere to be found.
I drove to Orlando. I'll go stay at a friend's house, and hopefully the dust would settle in a few days, and I'd come home. That's actually what I believed I was doing.
Burnside and Dorsey meet up at a hotel room and start planning their escape.
Man, how do you think we're going to get across the border?
The best thing for us to do was go to Mexico. We had connections there, people we could trust, probable phony passports could be arranged for, that kind of stuff.
Burnside wants one last moment to say goodbye to his wife, Tanya.
Me and my wife can have probably the most serious conversation that we've ever had in our lives, to say the least. Basically made plans for the future.
I'll go.
Blue Lagoon was a movie that was referred to in our conversation, that I was supposed to find a deserted island somewhere that we could go live happily ever after.
After a tearful farewell, Burnside's hit with another surprise. On August 15th, Dorsey decides to surrender to authorities. Faced with four counts of first-degree murder, Burnside makes a decision that will forever change his life.
My whole life is ruined. The life as I knew it was going to cease to exist. I got $2,000 in my pocket, and I got to go start a new life somewhere.
He calls the one person he can trust, his mother, who's living in Orlando.
My mother kind of took control because I was pretty emotional, stressed out. Really wasn't prepared to deal with this so quickly.
Burnside's mother, Susan, is a reservation clerk for a major airline carrier. She uses her employee privileges to get her son a free ticket to Washington, D.C.
I figured I would probably need a city with good public transportation at least, and a big city to kind of feel like I'm getting lost in. So Washington, D.C. was a perfect spot for that.
A week after the murders, Burnside flies to Washington, D.C. under a fake name and checks into a rundown motel. To save money, he quickly adopts a diet of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. At night, he gets drunk to numb his fears of being caught.
I was an emotional wreck. So at night, I would go get some beer, a bottle of booze or something, and drink enough to go to sleep every night. When I talked to my mom, sometimes it got hard, and I still miss Tanya, I still miss my son.
After a week of living in a rundown motel, Burnside's anxious to get settled.
I needed a place, a permanent place to stay. I needed a job. I needed ID, some way to get around. so I bought a bicycle. During the days, that's what I was doing, sightseeing, learning the town.
Burnside realizes he needs an alias to conceal his past. He takes on a new name, Scott Lazarus. With a new identity, Burnside moves into an apartment and gets a job for $6 an hour.
I got a job painting under the table, of course, and that's how I survived the whole time I was in Washington, D.C.
It's been 2 weeks since the violent Floral City murders. Back in Florida, numerous tips begin to roll in. Detectives decide to zero in on Burnside's mother, Susan.
We just made one assumption. There's one person that you'll always contact in your life will be your mother.
In late September, Citrus County investigators get a solid tip. They find out that Susan is flying to Minneapolis to attend a hobby trade show. Investigators are certain that she's planning a secret meeting with her son. It's their best chance to finally capture Burnside.
We pretty quickly determined that Scott Burnside's mother was going to be a resource for him. She worked for an airline. She had access to airplanes. She could move him around very easily.
Investigators quickly pull together a surveillance team. They follow Susan to Minneapolis and check into the same hotel.
We felt strongly that she was going to make contact with Scott.
Police believe they are hot on the trail of fugitive Scott Burnside. When Burnside's mother, Susan, makes a trip to Minneapolis, detectives suspect she's planning to meet with her son. Investigators follow Susan closely. But there's no sign of Burnside. They monitor her phone calls and never let Susan out of their sight. But by the fourth day, Susan still makes no attempt to meet with her son. She checks out of the hotel and gets back on a plane to Orlando. It's a dead end for investigators.
I don't know if she was leading us away from something, which is a possibility, but she didn't really make contact with anyone that we thought would be significant.
Back in Washington, D.C., Burnside feels a rush of loneliness.
I was really homesick. Anyway, I couldn't stand it any longer, even though I knew I can't call anybody in my past. The hardest thing was, without a question, was not seeing my wife, not being with her. So I called up her best friend. I said, hey, Michelle, where's Tanya?
Michelle tells Burnside that Tanya is staying in Philadelphia with another man.
And it just broke my heart. That was it.
Okay, thanks.
Gave me the phone number. I hung up, went straight to the train station. I was on a mission to go to Philadelphia, and I don't care if the police caught me or not at that point.
As soon as he arrives in Philadelphia, Burnside calls Tanya.
I talked her into coming down to the train station. I said, I don't care what you do to get here, I gotta see you.
3 hours go by, and Tanya still hasn't shown up. Then, he finally spots her walking towards him.
Tanya!
She showed up. And just looking at her, you know, I've done let my beard grow and I done dyed my hair. I'm wearing secondhand clothes. And she pulls up looking like $1 million. We talk. We cried probably more than we talked, but she still promised.
I promise.
She'd come live with me when I found that little special place. So she left, and that was it. I agreed to meet up at some future date, but I knew in my heart it was over.
Burnside can't get Tanya out of his mind. He's heartbroken and depressed. In addition, he's becoming more paranoid as each day passes. He decides to change his appearance.
I got some funny-looking glasses and grew a beard and a mustache, looking over my shoulder everywhere I went, of course.
Back in Florida, investigators continue to build their case against Burnside. They also begin collecting evidence to arrest Doc Sanders, since police believe he had the most to gain from Joanne's death. As Doc remains free, Burnside continues to live in fear.
I'm sitting here shaking in my shoes, and you know, knowing how intense the search is for me.
Burnside's greatest weakness are his emotions. The need to stay in contact with family is constantly putting him in danger of capture.
I figured it's a good time to have my mother bring my son to visit me.
When my dad went on the run, I was very confused at the time because I wanted to see him. I wanted to talk to him. I wanted to make sure he was okay. I didn't hear from him. No one knew anything.
In January 1991, Burnside asks his mother to arrange a meeting with his 11-year-old son, Charlie. It's been 5 months since Charlie has seen his father.
When we arrived and I see my dad, I did not recognize him. But yeah, once I got up to him and actually gave him a hug, I knew it was my dad, and it was a great experience for me.
You been being good for mom?
I missed my dad terribly while he was gone. I really needed him there with me because he was definitely my heart.
The visit makes Burnside feel normal again.
Nice.
He continues his painting job to make ends meet.
I was actually feeling human again. Got into a groove of doing what I needed to do to keep from getting locked up.
One night, Burnside decides to meet up with some new friends in Georgetown. It would be a decision that he would soon regret.
Got pretty loaded. Closed down the bars, went to a Big Boy's restaurant. Ordered a bunch of food. And I fell asleep at the table.
The waitress notices Burnside slumped over in his chair.
Ridiculous. You and the drunkie with Sleepington are out of here.
She tells his friend to get him out of the restaurant.
Well, my buddy Mike, he doesn't know that I'm a wanted felon.
You okay? See ya.
So he just helps me out to the car.
She got you. Sit. All right, please.
Puts me in the front seat of his car and continues eating his breakfast.
We just had a couple customers in here, totally unruly.
The waitress, I guess, didn't like that too much.
So you might want to come check it out.
And call the police.
Burnside passes out cold in the front seat of the car. Then, suddenly, he's jolted awake by a blaring light shining in his face.
Are you okay, sir?
Police knock on my window. Flashlight shining in my face. Step out of the car, sir. I step out of the car. Well, it's finally over.
January 1991. Wanted felon Scott Burnside is sitting in the back of a police car.
I'm bringing a meal since I'm 24 years old, approximately, and I'll see in about 10 minutes.
He's been arrested for public intoxication. The Washington, D.C. police have no idea they are dealing with a fugitive. When they arrive at the station, police officers are swamped by an overwhelming number of bookings.
I guess it's Friday night, I think, and it was so busy that they didn't have time to photograph or print me. They just let me sleep it off. I gave them some phony name. They kicked me out the door in the morning.
Burnside's luck is short-lived. He learns that he'll be featured on Florida's Most Wanted Fugitive Bulletin. Back in Orlando, Burnside's mother helps plan his next move. She obtains a passport for her son, using a different name.
I assumed identity of my mother's ex-husband's son, Stephen Rose Jr.
Burnside researches third world countries that don't have extradition treaties with the United States. He settles on Rarotonga, a tiny South Pacific island near New Zealand.
And it's truly a blue lagoon. I had planned that with my spot where I could call Tanya, my wife, and have her meet me there.
Meanwhile, the investigation in Florida heats up. On July 26, 1991, Dorsey Sanders, Joanne Sanders' son, is found guilty of first-degree murder. That same day, authorities arrest his father, Doc Sanders, in Key West. Investigators finally have enough evidence to charge Doc as a co-conspirator.
If you are an accessory, then you're just as guilty of making the plan as those who pulled the trigger.
On September 3rd, 1991, John Barrett, the accused hitman of the botched murder-for-hire plot, is sentenced to death.
There is no question that Florida's death penalty was written for John Barrett. I mean, you cannot engage in the behavior he engaged in and kill four completely innocent men without deserving the death penalty.
Then, the state attorney's office receives a mysterious package. It's a tape recording from Scott Burnside.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. This is Scott Burnside. I mean, let's just cut the crap here, guys. I'm willing to possibly sit down and talk to you and maybe even say all that I do know in court against the people involved.
Burnside wants leniency in exchange for testimony against the other conspirators.
You know, and I know, I didn't have these four people killed.
Once he was in a position where he was comfortable that we weren't going to figure out where he was, I mean, he's a used car salesman. He's a little arrogant by nature, so he taunted us.
Why do you offer me just my God-given rights and not electrocute me? I mean, you insult my intelligence. You guys, you're not messing with the dummy, okay? I've been under your noses and between your ears for a long time. But without me, fellas, I guarantee you never have a shot.
He made proposals, and they were hollow, completely empty. We never promised to do anything for Scott Burnside. I wouldn't have done that at that point.
Instead, detectives increased surveillance on Burnside's family and friends.
In an event like this, everybody associated is a suspect. Everyone.
This includes Burnside's sister, Cheryl, and 11-year-old Charlie, Burnside's son.
I remember when this all first happened, I played basketball a lot every day, at least four times a day. So every time I'd walk out of the house, you know, I could look over to the right or left and see an unmarked car with cops sitting in it. So I knew they were following me.
There's one person in particular that authorities relentlessly track, Burnside's mother, Susan.
We firmly believed his mother was the key to finding him, so we stayed on her. We followed her. We, as much as we legally could, listened to her phone calls, checked every payphone within a half a mile of her house, just trying to find links to where Scott might be.
In late September 1991, Burnside uses his fake passport and lands on the tiny island of Rarotonga. He's been running for over 13 months now.
When I got to Rarotonga, as I got off the airplane, they put a flowers on you, like they do in Hawaii. And it dawns on me, and I said, well, I might like it here, you know?
Burnside finds a place to live, gets a roommate, and settles into island life.
It's a tropical paradise. Mountains, palm trees, beaches, good fishing, scuba diving, great people.
I think once he arrived in Rarotonga that he felt, you know, a little more relieved, a little more relaxed, that he's far enough away now where they can't get him.
Back in Florida, investigators are making progress on Burnside's whereabouts. Authorities learn about his mother's massage parlor business in Orlando. They decide to take a closer look.
We sent investigators from our department to conduct investigation on her, and they ended up obtaining evidence that she was involved in criminal activity.
Okay, so you can make it at 5 a.m.
It's a lucky break for Florida investigators. They file prostitution and racketeering charges. In March 1992, nearly 20 months after the murders, a SWAT team storms the Wild West massage parlor.
Anybody out? Stay calm. You stay right there. Anybody out right now? Sit right on my right. Yeah. Sit right on my right. Keep those things right on.
There we go.
Once inside, they arrest Susan.
I'm doing just fine. Everything's fine. Can you show me
the arrest turns out to be a major turning point in the case.
Tell Dad to call the lawyer.
Here we go.
We didn't care what happened to Susan. We were interested in finding Scott. If agitating her helped us find Scott, we agitated her.
The cops set Susan's bail high. They pressure her to talk about her son. She refuses to give up any information about her son's whereabouts.
We knew she knew where he was. It was obvious. I mean, when he did want to reach out to us, it was through her.
Then she surprises authorities. Susan comes up with enough cash to post her bond and get out of the country.
it caused her to have to tap resources other than just the cash she had in her pocket, giving her mother's residence as collateral for her bond.
Fed up with the constant police surveillance, Susan and her husband jump bail. They decide to join her son in Rarotonga.
They called me when they were in L.A., told me that they'd be there the next day. She shows up, I meet him at the airport.
How are you?
She tells me about the SWAT team, and she's tired of it. She was so tired of having to deal with that surveillance.
Burnside's sister, Cheryl, is surprised to learn a bail bondsman is holding the deed to her grandmother's house. She decides to finally cooperate with authorities, tired of the strain her brother's life on the run is putting on the family.
She knew where there was a safe deposit box that the mother had given her a key to, and there was stuff in the safe deposit box that she thought might help us find Scott. There was a blank postcard from the Isle of Rarotonga in the Cook Islands, which is the territory of New Zealand. There was some New Zealand currency. It appeared very clearly that he was in the Cook Islands.
Authorities now have their man, and they're on their way to the South Pacific. Within a week of Burnside's mother and stepfather's arrival on the island, they abruptly start packing up. Burnside's just received an unexpected warning from a friend.
He said somebody had just called him from the authorities. They were asking questions about me, where I was living. I'm thinking that the authorities followed my mom, somehow tracked her to the island.
The three of them decide to flee to New Zealand. At the airport, Burnside is anxious as officials check their passports.
My mother and her husband were able to go through. But they got to mine and they stopped.
As officials scrutinize Burnside's passport, he can't escape the feeling that this is the end. But this time, it turns out to be a false alarm.
Did you get a stamp that you needed on your passport?
Burnside needs to get a different stamp for his passport.
Well, just tell me what I need to do.
He tells his mother and stepfather to get on the plane without him. Since it's Good Friday, all government offices are shut down. Burnside reschedules his flight for Easter Sunday.
I've got to find this guy that stamps your passport so I can get the next plane, which was Sunday.
Burnside gets his passport stamped on Sunday morning. But the delay will cost him everything. On Easter Sunday, Burnside is finally ready to board his plane. He hands his passport to airline officials. Then, he hears his name.
Burnside? Burnside? Scott Allen Burnside? Let me see your passport.
A couple of the local police officers stepped out from the corner and said, Mr. Burnside! Of course, I'm not paying him no mind. Scott Burnside, turn around. We know who you are. They didn't have no guns. I could have ran from them.
But instead, Burnside gives up on April 19th, 1992, after living on the run for more than 20 months.
Ready to come to terms with the long arm of the law. I'm tired of running. So I was ready to go back and face what I had to face.
Florida authorities breathe a final sigh of relief. They can't believe the chase is over.
He ran as far as he could possibly run. I mean, this place is literally on the other side of the earth from Florida. And we found him.
On January 19th, 1993, Scott Burnside is found guilty on four counts of first-degree murder, solicitation, conspiracy, and accessory after the fact. He receives four life sentences.
I'm going to prison for a long time. Now they're going to try to cook me. So yeah, it was a horrible experience.
2.5 months later, Doc Sanders goes on trial. On April 1st, 1993, the public is shocked to hear that the jury returns with a verdict of not guilty. Today, Scott Burnside is serving 4 life terms at Hardy Correctional in Bowling Green, Florida.
Scott!
As for his mother, Susan, she was battling cancer when she traveled to the South Pacific.
How are you?
She passed away in 1993. For Citrus County investigators, it was a case filled with endless twists and turns. A bungled, ill-fated conspiracy that resulted in the deaths of 4 innocent men.
Quadruple murders, huge in L.A. It's huge in Dallas. It's huge in Miami. But it's real big in a place called Citrus County.
Investigators will always remember Burnside as the fugitive who almost got away with it.